Good morning. We are so glad to be worshiping here together as one today at St. Bartholomew's Episcopal Church on this Easter Sunday. My name is Noreen Dubé. I'm a priest in the Diocese of Washington. After 26 years of parish ministry, I began to work as a chaplain at Asbury Methodist Village, where some of you are members.
Yay.
And I welcome you, therefore, to this Easter Sunday celebration. Now let us continue with our opening acclamation on page 1 of your bulletin. Alleluia! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Saying together, glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and then by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading.
Our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm is Psalm 118. Let's read it responsively by full verse. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever.
Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever.
The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation.
There are five songs for victory.
The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in us.
Our second lesson is from 1 Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I work harder than any of them, though it was not I, the grace of God that is with you. Rather than it was on the day, so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" But then when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side. They were alarmed, but he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Please be seated. Let us listen to the word of God spoken in the scriptures for today. This story begins with confusion and sadness. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, had gone to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body. Their hearts were broken, but they knew that at least by trying to do this traditional anointing, they might find some sort of resolution. It wasn't much, but they thought that this was the best they were going to be able to achieve. And then as they came to that tomb, they must have still been asking themselves, "Where is our hope?" And instead of finding the resolution they hoped for, they found that even that scrap of resolution was taken away. Jesus' body is gone. The tomb is empty. They have taken our Lord, and we don't know where they have put him. Many people have been struggling to believe during this situation. Some of us have dear friends or relatives who came down with COVID-19, and we don't even know how they contracted it, maybe. Or there are other people who, because of the way the economy went, are struggling to find a way towards retirement. There are people who've lost a spouse or a beloved friend. And in those times, it might be hard to find hope, to find a way through these struggles. When I read these scriptures about what happened to the disciples and to the women who went to the tomb between the time of Jesus' arrest, I can understand why they were asking, "How do we have hope when the one that we love and trusted in is gone?" But today I want to share the incredible good news about what happened on that first Easter day and what difference the power of that day made for the first disciples, and for those women. First of all, Easter Day makes a difference because it declares that God always has the last word. Let me share an illustration here. In the Louvre Museum in Paris, France, there's a large lithograph of Goethe's Faust done by a not very well-known painter named Friedrich August Moritz Rich. This painter did these lithographs for Goethe's book, Faust. And in this particular one in the museum, Faust is engaged in a very competitive game of chess with the devil, who is smiling smugly. He thinks he's going to win that game easily. And he's pointing down at the chessboard and gloating. However, anyone who knows how to play chess can see that the devil isn't going to win just yet. As a matter of fact, a few years ago, an internationally known chess player was admiring the painting and suddenly exclaimed, "Wait a minute, Faust has another move, and then he's gonna be the winner." I think that painting is a parable for us Christians because here we can see symbolized the good news of Easter. When we look at the cross on Good Friday, at first glance, it looks like evil has won. It looks like Jesus has been silenced forever. But then Easter morning reveals God has another move, the final victorious move of all time. Jesus comes out of the grave and into our lives with power and great glory. The second meaning found in these days is Easter means that we are forgiven people of God. The Apostle Paul, when he wrote to the church in Rome, shared what he believed to be the foundation of the gospel and its power, and the difference it made for those who believed. He said, "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Jesus died for the ungodly. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And so we can boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ." I'm reminded of a story that the famous spiritual writer Dwight Moody told about his work in prison, where there were many prisoners serving life sentences. One day, while Moody was there, the parole board chose to release one of the long life-term prisoners. The warden announced that the prisoners could choose by secret ballot one prisoner who they thought was most worthy of release. After the vote was taken, the warden called out the name of the person who had gotten the most votes: Reuben Johnson. Was silence. No one stood up. He said it again, "Reuben Johnson, will you stand?" And every convict turned and looked at Johnson. And as Moody said, here was sitting a man with tears streaming down his face. He was forgiven. He was free. And the reality of this, all that he could do was show tears of joy. When we have experiences of Easter, experiences of new life, then we're like that prisoner in some ways. We have reason to hope once again. What a difference Easter makes when we know we've been forgiven. And finally, Easter tells us that through Christ we can live with victory rather than with defeat. There was a historical incident that proved this once. Some of you who are students of history might know of this incident, and that was when General Wellington was fighting Napoleon at Waterloo. News began to be transmitted with lights across the channel to England, to all the people who were anxiously waiting the results of the war. And the words spelled out, Wellington defeated. And then there was a huge fog that came up, and England thought the battle was lost. Wellington defeated. But then, a half an hour later, the fog lifted, and they could see the whole message with a final word in it. Wellington defeated Napoleon. And the mood in Great Britain changed from one of tragedy to great triumph. The entire country exploded with a thunderous celebration as the news was relayed. Napoleon had been defeated. Similarly, after the crucifixion, the disciples thought that they were defeated. Their hopes were dashed. They believed that the last thing they'd seen, Jesus on the cross and being put in the tomb, was all they ever would see. It was very hard for them to believe the word of the women who came back and told them that they had seen Jesus, or the other disciples on the road to Emmaus. Easter was real. Important for us to know, especially in this time in which we're living, because we're all doing our level best to find hope, to find our way to Easter and to new life. But in fact, hope and new life are coming to find us. I'm as sure as I can be that Easter has, or soon will, come to all of us. Remember perhaps a time when you felt in deep despair, and then the despair lifted and hope came. It came from Jesus. Or that time when maybe your job had degenerated into just a job, and you could hardly stand up to get up in the morning and go in anymore. But then one day, some things came together, once again, you felt caught up in this being a vocation that you'd been called to. Hope came again, and it was Jesus. In these and other circumstances, the Spirit of God and the risen Christ is creating those resurrections. One spiritual writer put it beautifully. We know the outcome of the story. We don't have to remain in the tomb in the dark night. We do not have to wrap ourselves in grave clothes of self-pity or blame. We are the Easter people called out of darkness into light. So remember, it's Easter. We are being found ever new in the midst of the darkness by Christ. God is at this moment rolling away our stones and calling us out of our tombs. Come out, he says, hallelujah. Christ is risen, hallelujah. Because of that, our hopes will rise again too. I invite you to join in the world. words of our faith found in the Nicene Creed, page 4 in your bulletin. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Confidently bring before God the needs of all our world, asking God for remembrance. Christ is risen, Christ is risen indeed. God of life, gratitude and great joy, we laud you for the gifts of Christ's resurrection. On this day, give us hope, for Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen indeed. On this feast day, which brings joy to all Christians, we commit ourselves to work toward the unity of the church, that Christ's body may be one, for Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is risen indeed. Honoring the gift of Christ's risen body, may we rise to serve all those whose needs keep them from seeing themselves as the image of God. For Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
For all who have need of the gift of Easter, for all who journey from illness to health, from despair to hope, from grief to consolation, from loneliness to love, for all our brothers and sisters, that death may have no more power over us, for Christ is risen. Who suffer and all who mourn, that today the Lord God will wipe away all tears. For Christ is risen. To pray for our presiding bishop, Michael Curry, our bishops, Marianne and her buddy, Chilton Knutson, and Reverend Noreen Dubay, who is with us as our supply priest. We also pray for all those on our prayer list for whom prayers have been asked, and especially for our parishioners, Stevie Grimes, Linda Abrahams, Evelyn De Torres, Judy and Steve O'Neill, Aurora Dennison, Bob and Nancy Hardy, and Joyce Hawkins. And we also celebrate the April birthdays of Victoria Cross, Sonia Elgin, Clifford Elgin, Eric Zolkowitz, Caleb Hendricks, Graham Moore, and Coral Dennison. May we be one in faith, and all who have died in Christ, for our life is hid with Christ in God, for Christ is risen. God of life, we thank you for the mystery planted in us, the paradox of life from death, and community from scattered disciples. We praise you for the dying, which saves us from death, and for the rising, which brings us life. We pray as we live through Jesus the risen one, in the power of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Peace of the Lord be always with you. Service continues with the Eucharistic prayer B, which begins at the top of page 7. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, for he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By By his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. And therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God, power, might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna. And love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Bartholomew and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
invite you to join with me in our post-communion prayer on page 10 of your bulletin. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May the loving power of God, which raised Jesus to new life, strengthen you in new hope and enrich you in his love and fill you with his joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our glory.